So a very good morning to everyone that's here. I welcome you to 37th episode Gyaniki Tech Talks on structural integrity, considerations for future mobility. So now the world is now racing towards new innovative solutions in transportation, and the future of mobility is not too far now from here. So like for today, I'd like to introduce the guest for today, Mr. Nachiketa Patil, and managing partner, Elino Energy LLC. Mr. Nachiketa has his bachelor's degree with mechanical engineering from the University of Pune. His 15 years of experience working in this field hasn't deterred his interest to begin training for helping budding mechanical engineers achieve career growth as he founded the LLC Engineering Learning Center, where he has trained more than 350 plus budding engineers. He has also completed various projects in the field of railways, defense, automotive, and general engineering domains with his team from the Elino Energy LLC. It's an honor to have you with us today, sir. I welcome you on behalf of all the participants and team Gyaniki. We look forward to having a very interesting session with you.
Thank you very much for introduction. So let's start. Let me just share my screen. Yes, so I'm sharing full screen of mine, not just one program. It's a complete screen which I'm sharing. Purposefully, I'm keeping these slides just to move around. It gives me a little more, freedom. So let's talk about what is a structure, because we are going to discuss about structural integrity considerations in future mobility. So let's cut down what is a structure, what is exactly structural integrity, what are the various considerations, and how it applies to the future mobility. So this is kind of an interesting definition which I found on internet a couple of days back. So there are many definitions of what is a structure, and this is quite interesting definition for even it is much better suited for the mobility part. A complex system considered from point of view of whole, okay, rather than any single part. So when we call anything as a structure, we are not just talking about one single part. Okay, we are typically talking about a complete assembly, and that complete assembly is going to cause a past structure, that is a structure which is complying to various regulations, or it is going to cause a structure which is day in day out failing, like what we saw in the early stages of electric vehicle assembly, which was kit vehicles coming from China, and especially electric three wheelers in Delhi side, the northern side, and they were failing at the chassis. They were failing at various suspension points, and that's all to do with structural integrity. Okay, so a simple definition of structure with regards to a complex system is a complex system considered from point of view of whole rather than any single part. So a typical workflow, if I just create a workflow here, a typical workflow in any design house will be, there will be a concept, then there will be an engineering. The concept will be more to be fed with customer feedback, competition, market, etc., etc. What market needs, how should be the aesthetic, the color combination, all these things. And when it comes to engineering, it's all going to be whether we are able to manufacture it, whether it is going to be in the cost bracket or not, are we really supplying this particular part or not, all these things are going to come. So I'm not going to talk about this today, but the overall understanding of what is a structure comes from the engineering aspect, and it comes from various tests to be carried out. So when we are talking about engineering, we are not just talking about manufacturing. We are actually talking about designing it for various loads. Okay, so we'll go through what are the various loads and other bit. But before that, let's talk about ways of checking structural integrity. Okay, so there are three major ways of checking a structural integrity, and those ways are simply stated as you have analytical method where we have let's say force is equal to, or sorry, stress is equal to force per unit area. So this is a simple analytical equation which we have, and we can check what is the stress, we can check what is happening with this structure and other bit. Okay, or you have omega equal to, which is a natural frequency, equal to under root of k over m. So that simple analytical technique which we are using to find out what is exactly the natural frequency of a structure at the initial stage, what is the stress at the initial stage, all these things we are going to talk about. The second one is quite interesting, which is numerical methods. Okay, so which I work in, I'm still working almost 16 years now, 2005 August I started working in this field of numerical methods and computer aided engineering. So till this day, we are continuously working for defense, for electric vehicles, using these numerical methods. So this is a method which is approximate. First of all, it is very fast for complex problems. And because it is approximate, the engineering skills required to understand whether whatever we are getting as a result is true or not is kind of a tricky thing. People think that if a computer is generating a result, it will be always correct. That's not the case. The real-time basic engineering has to be applied to check whether whatever results we are getting using a numerical method are really up to the mark or not, or are they really near to that of a physical test or not. So this is very, very important. And people just forget that computers are just working on the input, which is given by the user. So if the user input itself is wrong, you are going to get wrong results for sure as an output. And the third most promising but extremely costly method is physical testing. Okay, so these are the three important methods which every single company follows. At different stages of the life cycle of a product design, every single company follows either an analytical method or a numerical method or a physical testing methodology. And all three are important, but at a different scale, they are important. Okay. So if you are having a very small, what you can say, a very simple single piece to be manufactured, or a single piece to be judged upon or tested upon, there is no need of going for a numerical method at the beginning, or no need to invest too much of a time in that. You may have an analytical method, a simplification, and just do a cross-checking and make sure that you are doing a physical prototype and test it. It's going to save a lot of time and cost. So not in all the cases you need a numerical method, but when we talk about this definition, when we talk about a complex system considered from point of view of a whole, it becomes a little tricky for basic analytical method and physical testing. Reason why we need CAE is to reduce number of physical prototypes. So this is the main intention of using a CAE, to reduce number of physical prototypes. So if a structure is a complex system, which is not just to be analyzed on the basis of a single part, but rather on basis of a complete, assembly, then the prototyping is also going to be, physical prototyping I'm talking about, is going to be costly enough. Okay, that you all can understand. So this is something which we are going to reduce. Okay, so ways of checking structural integrity are three: analytical methods, numerical methods, and physical testing. Out of which the physical testing is something which needs to be only done as a compliance. So it's just going to be a conformity test at the extreme end of a life cycle design or the product design. And it's just going to be done once. That's the ideal thing to be done. So I'll just give you a simple example. We came across 4 years ago. It was pretty new field for electric three-wheelers. There is a renowned company in Pune who is building electric three-wheelers. And they built a proto. They already built a proto. And then they actually asked us to do a structural analysis. They just built a proto, but they haven't tested it on road. they haven't took that particular vehicle on track. It was an electric three-wheeler. Simple classic case. So there is no data sharing here. But what happened is, in CAE, once we created a model, a CAE model, and we tried to load a single wheel bump, that is a front wheel bump, a 2G load or a 3G load, a rear wheel bump or a rear wheel, both the wheels on a pump, all these things which we did for the electric three-wheeler testing, which was not regulatory, government regulatory, it was more of a compliance to in the point of view of a customer and the durability of a structure. We always got a bend. We always got a failure at the steering column stuff. And it was quite surprising to them because they thought in CAD it looks all fine, but why it is failing in CA? And then we asked them to just, as you have prepared a proto, you can just drive it on road for some 10 kilometers. And then they really drove that and it failed in first kilometer itself, exactly at the same point where we predicted. So basically it's not a magic. The point of understanding or what we have to understand here is physical prototype should come extremely last. It should not be something to be done at the initial stage for the structural integrity part. Now let's talk about what are the structural integrity tests which are possible. And before that, I'm just going to have two or three things to be conveyed. So there are tests which are divided as government regulations. Okay, then we have kind of a Google review, which is called New Car Assessment Program. You must have heard this for many ways, from Maruti Suzuki's point of view, from Tata Motors point of view, from Mahindra's point of view, and even from Global NCAP's point of view. So we have something which is non-compliance, or I'll just simply call it as it's a safety test, but not mandated. Whereas government regulations are mandated, you must do that. And then you have in-house testing. Okay, and this in-house testing is, for some companies, it is extremely critical. For example, Ford or Tata Motors or for Mahindra, these guys take this internal or in-house testing so seriously that this sometimes surpass whatever is the government regulation. Whereas for some companies like Maruti Suzuki, where they openly claim that we are only going to comply to the government regulations, we are never going to comply to something which is not being put in the book. Okay, so that's what they have categorically said. So it's everyone's business decision. Now, the point here is, the government regulations, as I said, they are mandatory. This is more like a Google review. Okay, and this is more like a sustainable business model, where you have too much in-house tests to make sure that customer gets the best experience. Okay, so these three are the main categories, and most of the electric three-wheelers, four-wheelers have to comply this. Okay, we don't have a global NCAP. There is no NCAP for new car assessment program for electric two-wheelers and three-wheelers. There are very few structural regulations for government to put forward in front of electric three-wheeler or two-wheeler manufacturers. And it is more on the manufacturer's side that they have to comply internally various different tests or situations. Okay, so basically, what we can say, a test, a regulatory test is nothing but a laboratory event. It's a laboratory event, and which is in a controlled environment. Whereas in reality, the accidents or the various types of structural loads can happen in a completely different way. That's always going to be the case. So when we come to this particular list, let me write down, we are focusing on these in-house tests, various in-house tests. Let's try to talk about the structural integrity tests which can be carried out in-house, which anyone can perform, any electric two-wheeler, three-wheeler manufacturer can perform. why I'm not focusing more on electric four-wheelers in this particular group is, we really know that we are nowhere close to electric four-wheeler as far as a small industry or a startup being considered, because it involves too much of a cost for testing. The NCAP or even the government, Indian government regulations, the IS standards to meet upon, it's going to take too much of an effort as well as money. So right now, just let's focus on two-wheeler, three-wheeler segment, where the government regulations are not that great. That means they are not too much of a tight regulations as far as the structural integrity is concerned. But having said that, to sustain in the market, to make sure your product is going to perform extremely well for a very long time, you need a lot of in-house testing to be done. So this list is quite interesting. A static load, I just placed it with some fill in the blanks. So you have structural integrity test, which is a static load. For example, you have a torsional rigidity, you have a bump loading, okay? You have and it's all getting converted from a dynamic loading and to an equivalent static load. Then you have dynamic loads, which are more of a 2G, 3G loads, and more of PSD data. You must be all of you must be knowing this. It is power spectral density, which is basically a road condition being mapped for 3,000 kilometers or 30,000 kilometers. More the length of the road, better will be your understanding with regards to the product performance in event of various road conditions. So the Indian road condition data typically is available with ARAI, which they supply at some cost or maybe sometimes free. It all depends on how your relation with ARAI or ICAT is. So you have a dynamic load situation where the fatigue durability are being taken into account. So you have fatigue and you have durability. And then the last one, which is noise, vibration, and harshness, because these two are interlinked. So if you have something which is getting loaded above the fatigue failure life, then it's all going to fail. There can be a rotating part, it can be a translatory part, or it can be just a weld. So welds also can fail in fatigue. And typically we all are working on weldings or adhesives or bolting joints or allens or other bit. Okay. So this is something which needs to be considered in an in-house environment for structural integrity. Now for future mobility, what is happening? Okay, just coming to the point of future mobility, what is happening? This fatigue durability is to be analyzed with regards to newer materials or newer forms of materials. We are fortunate to work with Arrival of UK. You must be all knowing the name. We are working with adhesives. We are working with the composites. And we are also working with aluminium screwing and the bolting and other bit. Okay. So basically, when we talk about fatigue durability, we are talking about newer kind of materials, which are composites, which are non-metals, or which can be metal-non-metal combination, or it can be manufactured in a completely different way, like what Arrival is doing. So we have different types of materials to be taken into account for future mobility, because it's not just mobility which is going futuristic. It is materials which are also going futuristic. That's a fact, and that's happening. So to make it lightweight, to make it more sustainable, the hydrogen cars or the battery electric vehicles or anything for that matter, it all needs to be structurally optimized. Okay, you will have bionic structures, you will have not just angles like they are at an angle or something. They will be bionic structures, 3D printing and other bit, which is all going to come across. The point which I want to state here is, when we do structural integrity tests, either for, let's say, static load or for a dynamic load or for fatigue or durability or for NVH, we must consider a replacement of a conventional material into the newer material. Okay, that has to be taken into account before even we. So right now, maybe some companies are using the conventional materials, which is perfectly fine. But at the same time, if we just move on with the newer types of materials, that has to be taken into account. So either your partner, if you are not able to do it in-house, either your partner or someone who is into a research has to have a clear knowledge about what are the various non-conventional materials which you are going to use for your future mobility requirements. Okay, so that is something which is kind of important. And this is what I discussed. So basically, we have to reduce number of prototypes, we have computer-aided engineering. And all these tests, whichever I mentioned here, all these tests, the even there are some more tests like CFD is there, computational fluid dynamics is there, or electromagnetics is there, or the radar signatures for the self-driving cars is there. All these things are possible to be taken into account or to be solved using computer-aided engineering techniques. Okay, so you can have your in-house department to be set for complete CAE process, and that's quite possible for good large-scale companies or medium-scale companies. But for small-scale companies, it's just going to be a business decision of either we do it in-house or are we going to outsource it. So that's all a logical decision to be taken into account. So when we talk about, just to get a summary, when we talk about structure, we are talking about various different in-house tests for business sustenance. Okay, so there are many companies who have copy-paste products. There are many companies who have complete original products. And there are many companies who have a hybrid product. Okay, nothing wrong in all three models. As a business, it's perfectly fine. Everyone copied something from someone and then they evolved. So the point here is evolve. So you can copy at the initial stage and then evolve. That's what a clear choice should be. But if you just keep on copying and then don't evolve at all, and because somebody launched a product and you are going to launch a product and don't take into account what customer needs. So the feedback mechanism from the customer side is extremely important. So if you are manufacturing an electric two-wheeler, which is performance oriented, and if your suspension setup, if your noise vibration harshness setup, and your chassis stiffness is not optimum because you haven't done any in-house testing and you just want that product to be working in your mind, then it's never going to happen. So there is a lot of virtual testing, virtual prototyping involved when it comes to future of structure, future of the mobility part or the structural integrity of a future mobility part. So this is what I just wanted to convey, that just be focused on the initial stages, just be focused on the design more than creating a prototype. You can have a mock-up, but just focus on creating a prototype at a later stage. Mockup is perfectly fine. And then you can use these advanced numerical techniques to make your product sustainable, to make your product, customer worthy. Okay? So it should be a desirable product. The cost is not just the factor. Okay, there are many factors which are causing the tendency towards that product to buy that product. So not just cost, the overall looks, the overall understanding, the durability and easy serviceability, all these things matter a lot. Okay. Thank you. That's all from my side. I think I'm in time, right?
Yes, thanks a lot for the quick session. It's like true experience being shared. So thanks a lot for that. We have a few questions. Okay. And first, there are some questions which are already there on the chat window. So I'll start with those. So Mr. Ashwini Mishra has a question. Basically, as part of the customer requirement that they are seeing in the L5 category, they are asking for a warranty of 3 years and 1 lakh kilometers. So his question is, how simulation can help to meet such requirements with close accuracy?
Yeah, it's a very relevant question. So there comes a point of this fatigue and durability consideration, and typically the road data. Okay, so when it's being said that it is 1 lakh kilometer, nobody is going to state that out of that 1 lakh, 50,000 will be highway, some 30,000 will be city, and the other bit is going to be what I can say, a very rough rural road. Nobody is going to state that. So we have to be very vigilant in understanding what is our product, where we are launching it, and what is the end user being trying to abuse. Is that end user trying to abuse it or not? And when I say abuse, it's not purposeful. It's the need of a time for that customer. So we have to take into account what is the duration of the cycles. The PSD, power spectral density data, as I said, it's being available with ARI or ICAT that we have to buy. That data is actually representation of a road for some 3,000 kilometers where you will have pulses. And those pulses we convert in a numerical format. And then we apply that particular. So, for example, if six people are sitting in electric three-wheeler, for example, or let's say 600 kilogram mass is there as a payload, and that 600 kilogram mass is being traveled for let's say 50 kilometers, and in that 50 kilometers you have a rough road, you have a fine road, you have a highway, and all these three things are there but in a different way. So that PSD will take into account what is happening, and then we can predict what is the failure point, what is the life at which it fails, or what is the life expectancy which we have for the complete system. I'm not talking about one product or one part. So this is quite possible in the event of structural durability tests or fatigue tests, which we carried out day in, day out. Okay, so it is possible. Simulation can help you a lot.
Okay, thanks. Ashwini, does that answer your question, or you have a follow-up?
Yeah. You can unmute and talk, not a problem.
Sure. So thank you very much for your nice sessions. So I just wanted to understand regarding accuracy level. So simulation definitely can help, but what at accuracy level, if I'm saying, let's say 2% plus minus?
It is more than 80% of the correlation. Now, again, a very good question. As I categorically mentioned earlier, that it's an approximate method. Numerical methods are always approximate. They are not going to give you accurate results at any point of time. The engineer has to make sure that whatever results we are getting are correct, in the sense they are going to make any sense or not. That's what a CA engineer or CA analyst has to find out. So the accuracy depends on the input data which a customer provides. So a material testing has to be done in a very clear way. For example, what happens? For let's say for non-metals, or let's take a simple example of a metal, an SN curve, which is stress versus number of cycles curve, has to be very accurate. If you don't have an accurate SN curve itself, and if you are assuming an SN curve, then the accuracy is going to go down, because there is an assumption which is coming up, and that may not be too much of a suit for you. So if you have physical testing data for the material which you are going to use for your structure, then the accuracy level increases exponentially. Okay. Other than that, everything else is a physical data.
So if I would say, if I want to make the first time write proto, because proto time and cost is very high, and looking at the product to market is very limited. So considering the proto development time and cost, if I want to make a first time write proto, then what are the input? You said one thing, very good thing, like material tested are important to perform the right simulations. That's very, very important thing. What else I need to take care to improve the accuracy of my simulations?
You have to be very specific with the joineries. See, what happens typically is we have last minute changes, which we do at the proto level. So we change from bolting to welding, or we increase the weld length, or we change from welding to bolting, or we use adhesive. All these things we do for the final proto, and whatever we did for the CAE, there it is different, and for the proto it is different, then you will not get a good correlation. That's one point. So basically, as you rightly said, that first time write proto, that if that's the approach, the first important thing is a very accurate CAD data, 3D CAD, very accurate. no penetrations, no intersections, no parts going inside the other. The second is joineries. Okay, so not just the CAD data, the joineries are extremely important. And the third is the materials which you are using. So what typically we suggest, I'll just give you a simple example. One of our customer had a seat, which was a commercial vehicle seat, which is nothing but a bus seat, bus passenger seat, was being tested. It's an H1, H2 test, which is being carried out. So this H1, H2 test, they used a different material for a CAE test, and they had a completely different material for their proto. So when we went to PRAI, the results were completely inaccurate with regards to CAE. Then we tried to go to the root cause. So as I said, first thing is accurate CAD, second is very correct joineries, and third thing is a tested and controlled material. That's what is lacking. So initially it may be a little costly to control the material quality, because typically the steel mills, they are going to supply you a material which is having a range. So it can be EN19 or not just a tool steel, but anything which is going to have a range of yield. So it's not just going to be something which is, let's say, 240 megapascal is going to be the strength or yield strength. It will never be 240. It will be either 190 or it will be 280. And we really don't know, because that's not controlled batch. So if you can do that, if you can, as a manufacturer or as an OEM, if you can control the quantity which you are procuring, it may be less, it may be a little high cost, but if you tell them that, okay, I want a specific grade of material in this quantity at the initial stage, just to build a correct proto, the accuracy of the physical testing and CAE will be very close, or correlation, I would call it.
Sure. So considering the two-wheeler and three-wheeler, it's very, very, low cost and commercial applications, where people are, difficult to, going for material testing costs a lot of time and investments, right? And again, going add to the, again, final product, which may go up as per competitions. So how to handle these kind of contradictions?
The answer to this is cluster. See, we have to come together to create a database of our own self. So we all will contribute in material testing. We all will contribute in the, as far as cost and efforts and timing. Because what is happening, everyone is doing the same test.
Correct.
And they are getting a different, they may be getting the same data, but they may be getting a different data. But if you have an averaging done, if we all do a material testing of a common parts, at least for, let's say, a stamped part is there, or an ERW tube is there, or we all are using ERW, right? Everyone uses ERW. Now, if we just make sure that we are testing various different grades of ERW together as a consortium and as a cluster, maybe that will give an upper edge in reducing the cost. And you can buy that particular database by paying some money, which will not be to an extent of preparing a sample, then going for a test, NABL accredited lab, then get a test report, then actually discretize it into LS Dyna or any kind of a CAE data. If you can directly get a CAE data for a particular material, and if somebody has a good tie-up, good sense of understanding, and maybe a Shekhar sir or anyone who is a leader in this particular area, if you guys can come up with a consortium kind of thing where you are only creating a material database, I think that will standardize many things and it will reduce too much of a cost. Am I making sense?
Yes, right. Sure. Thank you very much. Thank you for great session and your time. Thank you.
This is something that we do have ambitions to do under Gyaniki. But okay. Obviously, it needs the consortium to pitch in. So yeah. we are still at ground level, but this is something that people like.
Yes, I think Prashant, Deepak Samant sir has a question. He's from Mahindra. Which are the tests for validating EV powertrain structural integrity, and what are the IS international standards? Okay, another point of view from my side. For electric vehicle powertrain, if it is any electric vehicle, the main structural integrity test is battery nail penetration and battery G-loading. Okay, because batteries cause a lot of trouble. You must have seen in the recent days some catching fire incidents. So battery nail penetration in the box. So we have a battery box, and it should not be causing any kind of a nail to go into it. The nail penetration has to be, and it's a regulation. So it's a compliance to be done. You cannot just escape out of it. Other than that, as far as the chassis are concerned or the suspension setup are concerned, it's all up to you. Nobody is going to bother whether it is a soft suspension chassis or the chassis is rigid or a flexible chassis or whatever it is.
Vibration test is also there, huh?
Yeah, that's what the G-loading tests are typically important. Vibration test, what happened, I'll tell you. There are two things which we have to consider. The first thing is vibration, which is coming from road, which is again, as I said, power spectral density to be considered, or vibrations which are coming from the electric motor. Now, typically, the vibrations from electric motor are not that big as compared to that of an IC engine vehicle. So vibration testing is internationally mandatory, but for Indian standards, it's not mandatory as such. There are some amendments. I'll just take a look at the amendments if I don't want to give you a wrong information. So if there are any amendments, I'll just read it through, the updated one. And if it is a compliance, because we are moving very fast with regards to reaching to the international standards, except crash and safety. Crash and safety, we are very negligible people. We ourselves have a negligence. Inherently, we are talking about kitna deti hai and all other bit. We don't care about what happens in crash. So that's a different area. But at least for various electrical, electronics, EMI, EMC, and other bit, the nail penetration is already there in IS standard, AIS standard to be specific. So that is quite possible.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, sir.
We have next question. What will be the and skill required for three-wheeler company in form of engineering perspective?
The point here is you will need a better design engineers first. When I say design engineers, I really don't mean a CAD guy. Okay? A CAD is just a tool part of it. A 3D modeling is just tool part of it. My suggestion is to have a very good engineering skill guy who is good in hand calculations, who understand what is happening in reality, and the guy who is really able to communicate with the proto department as well as with the CIE department. If you have that pivotal point, see, the CIE part you can outsource. Reason, the software costs is too much. The overall electric three-wheeler, so just to give you an idea, if you are using some software called Altair Hypermesh, it's costing us something between 9 lakh to 9.5 lakh rupees per year per seat. Now you can imagine there will be three electric three wheelers being manufactured in that particular costing bracket for one software, one seat, and that's not even a whole package. So what my suggestion is, you can go light, but make sure you are investing on an engineering skills, not on CAD skills. What the biggest mistake what we may do is, we only go for a 3D modeling skill. And the material knowledge, what is ERW people, the fresh engineers or even an experienced engineer doesn't know what is electric resistance arc welded tube, ERW tube is. It's not a seamless tube. It's a cost-effective way of creating from sheet metal to the tube. They really don't know. So if you have someone who is having that knowledge prior to the joining, maybe that will be a right candidate. So the initial thing I would suggest is somebody who is having a good experience in manufacturing, at least understanding what are the various manufacturing methods, or someone who is having a very good knowledge with regards to hand calculations. Making sense, the physics, if that is making sense, then yes, of course, it's going to be a very important part. What percentage of Indian two-wheeler startups do you feel are not engineering the right way? I haven't driven too many electric two-wheelers, to be very frank. I have driven the Ather for sure, IQ, TVS IQ, Chetak, yes, Okinawa one or two models, I really don't know, and that's all. So I may not be a correct person to comment on this. What percentage of Indian two-wheeler startups? The point is there, the people are taking engineering very seriously nowadays. But that does not mean we are considering ourselves as structural, what you can say, supreme structural manufacturers. We are still into evolve period. Ather has taken a good leap there. You have TVS, which is always performs well in case of handling, ride, durability, everything. They are the racing racing company. They know how to create a product. So that's one part. Chetak, I was never impressed. It's not that great product, to be very frank. It's limited with speed. It has that mushy feel. The suspension is not that great. But that's all my personal opinion. Okay. So if we are talking about percentage, may not be really able to. There are many startups who are in stealth mode. We really don't know whether they are going to launch a product or they are building a product or not. So that's something which has to be taken into consideration. Should product focused companies outsource this work or do it in-house? Now that's a management call. But for me, if I'm going to manufacture something which is, or if I'm going to do something which is not my own expertise. So for example, my expertise is battery management, the chemistry of a cell or anything like that, and I'm good in all the electronics part and the the overall electromechanical stuff, I would completely outsource that to someone who is only doing a structural part, because that way it helps a lot. Okay, because you have a complete different team working close to you. You have to trust someone. Now, of course, the service provider has to build their trust, but you have to trust someone who is outside. As I said, as I gave you an example of that electric three-wheeler manufacturer, their products are now running on the road. They are flawless, and they clocked around some 1 million kilometers collectively, some 10, 15 different prototypes on highway, on rural roads, etc., etc. So the point is, if you have a right partner with you, consider anyone who is to whom you are outsourcing as a partner. If you give that kind of a responsibility, then of course there will be results. I will not be commenting on chances of failures, because there are many companies who think that they have done a lot of things in structural integrity, but they really don't know the product. So that's something which is, like, as I said, a management decision, Shekhar sir.
We do not have further questions. I think we can end it. So do you have any parting words before we can?
So thank you very much, Gyaniki and the whole team. I'm really very much thankful to you guys for asking me to come down and talk about it, Shekhar sir, especially the material database stuff, which is a need of a time now. If we can have a small contribution, even I will be happy to contribute as far as cost and knowledge and anything which is being taken into account. We will have a better way or better path to move forward. That's what my understanding is.
Thank you everyone for joining. I think I'll go over the meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining.